Hey guys, I've given this talk a couple of times now at different intelligence communities and stuff like that. I went to a DHS ATTE conference, which stands for Advanced Threat Technical Exchange. It wasn't very technical, so I took out a lot of the technical portions just to come to a conference where everything is very technical. So, sorry about that. We have a lot of cool images and fun things for managers, which is normally who I brief, but the majority of this presentation is better as a conversation, so we're going to breeze through this, and most of what's going to happen at the end of it, if you guys have questions, let's push questions through. I kind of have a feeling you're going to, because of the nature of what we're doing. Basically, what we work on is what's called the ECS program. The ECS is a sister program of Einstein. Who's all heard of Einstein that DHS has? A lot of people. So, I mean, it is actually an exact replica of the Einstein program. It's for U.S.-based commercial infrastructure, though. And so I work on an ISP, I work for an ISP on this program where we cover down and we monitor for foreign intelligence, terrorist organizations, and highly funded crime syndicates activity in U.S.-based critical infrastructure. The way that the program works, interested parties like ISP, CenturyLink, Verizon, AT&T, other people are part of the program as well. They get cleared. Intel comes from federal intel communities. DHS collects from intel communities, and clear parties identify vehicles to leverage intel in commercial spaces. So basically what that means is we set up a spot for them to be able to route their traffic through us. We monitor for classified intelligence in commercial organizations. Obviously you have to take people from previous spaces, like agencies, whatnot, who have access to that intel. They can read it, they can identify it. Whenever there's enriched data that's necessary, you submit downgrade requests, whatnot. So that's kind of just the background of the program itself. I'll give kind of a little bit of an overview really quickly, again, what it is, but we're gonna go into what we're doing with the basics of intel, how we're manipulating data using unclassified attributes of classified intel to identify classified intelligence before it becomes classified, and then I can push it out to the commercial community. I forgot I was in charge of this. Basically, what I just went through, intel communities push to Homeland Security, which then goes down to CSPs, which then we cover down for critical infrastructure in the United States. One of the largest conversations that's happening right now is how we can play a role in the elections platforms. Of course, that's a buzz and everything, as you may or may not know, but ECS is on Schedule 70 to be able to cover down for that, so that's one of the things that we're driving right now moving forward in that case. The way that we do that fundamentally is by setting up IPsec tunnels to organizations, having them route their DNS traffic back and forth to us. So we cover down on DNS, SMTP, and NetFlow indicators. Right now we're just gonna talk about DNS. So in organizations, not every organization has people with clearances. So whenever they see something bad and we're gonna hit them up and say, hey, we saw this, it's bad, they're like, why is it bad? Well, I can't really share that with you, you just have to trust me. I'm like, yeah, I'm not gonna trust you. I don't trust people I'm paying for indicators with, and I come back through and they actually give me intel, I still don't trust the intel. So I'm not gonna trust you if you're not giving me anything. So how can we shift that around and open up a further conversation? So basically, non-mature organizations are gonna come through and say, well, we actually can't identify where the threat's at. We're just dealing with DNS traffic. How can I identify where it's coming from? Well, being able to basically implement honeypots, WebRTC on, leveraging WebRTC on those Apache frameworks allows for us to identify source IP addresses of infected threats, and the utilization of NetFlow traffic across wire are all different ways that can leverage and be used to identify an infected host. So again, what we're kind of going back through here, if you're somebody that offers IOCs, if you're somebody that's collecting IOCs, if you're somebody that's doing anything with IOCs, on the front end of it, collect your intel, put it in one spot. Whenever you guys come to a conversation, exactly what Keynote was talking about this morning, when you come to that conversation, be ready to share. Be ready to bring stuff to the table, be ready to actually give it up, because I mean, DHS is pushing down classified intelligence to whatever they can to help cover down on monitoring of intelligence in critical infrastructure. If you guys are aware of things, hey, we are also aware of activity that's going on here. It's the same exact infrastructure, but these domain names, these IP addresses you guys may not be aware of. We'll collect it, we'll integrate it, we'll use it in our statistical analysis. Again, MITRE at the top of the page is, of course, a buzzword for this conference, which is great. I mean, it's a great platform. It's what we use for the aggregation of our intelligence and being able to sort of group together the attributes of our data. A bunch of other different pieces where you can get information on APTs, terrorist organizations, and crime syndicates. Of course, there's tons of different things that you can monitor for. Somebody downloads something from Metasploit and they create something that's got a hash on it. I don't care. You know, we're not covering down on Bob. We're not looking for Bob or George down the street. We're looking for the organizations that I just talked about. So these are where you'll be able to find them. Okay, so automating the hard work. Again, kind of going back to that, you guys can sort of see we're covering down on 23 different actors, and you can sort of see the outliers here, which is pretty synonymous with what's going on in the commercial industry, what everybody else has been reporting. Hey, these are the organizations with the highest hitting activity. Of course, DHS is not gonna let us put, hey, this is APT 28, 29, but you guys do the math. So this is essentially what we're doing. We're pulling information in. We're doing active blocking, inline blocking of known bad indicators. And then we're actually taking the attributes of our known bad indicators and then putting them into different databases. And when I say attributes, I mean TTLs of DNS names, when it was registered, everything that Umbrella talked about yesterday. We're essentially doing the exact same thing, but we're doing it with classified intelligence. Again, anything I'm gonna say up here is not gonna be new. We've already talked about all of it. It's the source of the data that's basically different in our case. Again, that conversation that if you guys wanted to be involved in that, say, hey, we'd love to be able to see the intel that you're producing, that you're coming up with after this, and share it with the rest of the community. We're happy to do that. Reach out to me, contact me. We're happy to provide the information back to you guys. Hey, these are other indicators we're finding. And then going back to the source to identify what processes are initiating these to validate that it's actually a threat. So things we're gonna go over really quickly, DGA, exposure, and pattern-based algorithm. Again, talked about a lot of these also. We're just gonna go over really quickly. Models used for this are, the DGA basically training it once. If you guys wanna talk about this a little bit more, I'm not gonna bore you with this, it's almost lunchtime. But exposure model, it actually needs to be trained multiple times. You have to use a lot of different data, you have to train it, you have to look at it again, train it again, train it with known goods and known bads. This, essentially what I just said, allows for us to identify unclassified domains leveraging classified data. So in DGA, if you guys know the life cycle, there's like five or 600 different ways that a DGA can produce a domain or hash. This right here is the model used for using the same NTP server. So you grab a timestamp, you have the same MTP server, the timestamp becomes your hash, you push your hash through, and that way your C2 and your client know what the domain is supposed to look like. So as you can see, we basically just come up and, showing you guys randomly generated, dictionary-based generated, and hybrid-generated domains. Exposure again uses the attributes of it, what we can see as it goes across the packet size, TTL associated, when was it registered, who was it registered by, email addresses registered, what geographical location of an IP address was used to register the domain, every aspect of that. It's pushed into there, we push it back through, we have a localized database, and all of the monitoring of it is all done passively. Obviously, we can't do monitoring of inline traffic as it goes across because there's just too much traffic and it's too quick. Whitelisted, obviously, Trend Micro, Semantic, and Verizon, they all use DGA and different types of exposure stuff like in their domain names. So you have a lot of false positives, so you have to whitelist different types of stuff and blacklisting things. I think Babinek was also discussed yesterday, Alien Vaults and AISs. AIS is another good source that DHS pushes out. And some of them are validated, some of them are not validated. Sort of take it with a grain of salt, but at least there's something there for you guys to be able to use. Exposure model attributes, again, TTL, registration, IP variations, responses, daily trends, and cost per query. So if you guys have any questions on that, I'm happy to discuss it later. the pattern-based algorithm. Pattern-based algorithm is really near and dear to my heart because it's one of those things that I helped develop based on my time as an offensive security operator, an offensive intelligence operator. So I know lots of the callback intervals are configured specific ways with randomized variables in there that say, hey, instead of callback every 2 hours, use a randomized variable that says callback every 1 hour and 45 minutes to every 2 hours and 15 minutes, which then makes it nearly impossible to say, hey, this is a, you know, 2 hour time interval. So we pull all the attributes back together, identify a scope bandwidth because some pieces of malware are actually configured to get all of your commands you're supposed to run at one time, process all of them and push them back so you don't need to do another query again for an IP address. But some of them are designed to, you know, call out, get the IP address of your domain that's set to a TTL of 1, run a command, do it again. So then you have groupings of callouts that go over the course, and that actually tends to break your algorithms whenever they're not, I mean, it just doesn't process properly. So you have to identify when the piece of malware woke up and when it went back to sleep. And sometimes that can be 15, 20 minutes if it's not actively being used. So you basically have to group together, and so we use sklearn in Python to do that to be able to cluster those for us. So basic callback interval would be set to 7,200 seconds, which is 2 hours. That's sort of the base. It could be set to 2 hours, it could be set to 24 hours, it could be set to anything. Just depends on how much data you're able to collect and put into your database to process your algorithm through. This is kind of the process that goes through. Again, it gets like extremely technical. It's right before lunch, I'm not gonna do that. It's also, you know, raining out. I think it kind of makes people tired. If anybody has any questions, just let me know. So again, kind of when we put the data back together, we sort of start to be able to see configured intervals. Obviously, you have to take out your outliers, and you see your variations and things start to become a little more clear. So again, as I said, we're not the only people doing this. I just took a Black Hat course in Vegas from Cylance. They're doing stuff with DGA as well, and they're doing a really great job at it. If you guys have any questions about that, I know there's some Cylance people here, but look up Tom Pace on LinkedIn. He's, you know, happy to have a conversation with you about it. We're gonna go back through kind of, this is sort of the alerting platform methodology that you can use for that. Elk and Splunk, I mean, Splunk is expensive. If you wanna do this and you're low cost, use Elk, use Greylog. You know, they're both methodologies you can use that are really inexpensive. But you can kind of see the way that it comes in. We pull a tap, an optical tap, passive optical tap, database it. In the database of the attributes, we pull the information out with the algorithm, and then process data, generate alerts. Alerts go back out to a human, and then that gets pushed back out to the end user. Again, being able to put the information in, and basically what we're doing is we'll be able to tag information in Elk. If you guys aren't familiar with that, looking up tagging information in Elk, it's a really easy way to be able to add filters to it and look at it for data that's already in there. Chances are you're probably aware of it. Again, this is Cylance interface. They're doing a really great job. This is their DGA model that they're using, predictions, analysis, and whatnot. And they're, right, and so essentially you're able to see kind of different types of statistical analysis when things are, outliers are processed through and how they're viewed in maps. Okay, thanks guys.